Good morning. It's good to see everyone that's here. It's good to want to welcome everyone that's streaming online. So I hope that as we start our Christmas season, celebrating the birth of Jesus, that your heart is full of joy as we worship together, whether we be here or whether we be online. And 'tis the day to start singing our Christmas songs. So we'll be doing that. Now, we only have 3 weeks, so we'll sing our Christmas songs and just worship together. So let's go ahead and prepare to do that. Will you please be standing? I'll share Psalm 98, 4 and 9, and then we'll be singing together, Joy to the World. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth, for he comes. Joy to the world. God, we do thank you for this Christmas season, for this time that we celebrate your birth. And Father, we thank you that you loved us so much that you gave the perfect gift in your Son, Jesus, who was willing to come to this earth, be born, live a sinless life, and sacrifice himself on Calvary. Father, I thank you that we just lift up praises this morning because it did not end at the cross. It started at the manger, went to the cross, and ended in his resurrection. And we thank you for that this morning. And I praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Angels, we have heard on high, sweetly singing. prolong. Say, what may the tidings be which inspire your heavenly song?
I know it is the Christmas season, but each and every week during whatever season we're in, we remember what Christ did on Calvary when we gather around the table and we partake of the Lord's Supper. So as we prepare for that this morning, let's be singing, "Are You Washed in the Blood of the Lamb?"
For the cleansing power, are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you rest each moment in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? When the bridegroom cometh, will your robes be white? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Will your soul be ready for the mansions bright and be washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Lay aside the garments that are stained with sin and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. There's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Go be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Amen. So as we prepare for communion this morning, I was doing some research online, and I came across a meditation that I liked, and it's from the Laurel Canyon Church of Christ, which is in Columbus, and Jason Hardin is the writer of it. It says, Jesus died that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. Why did Jesus die? He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. 1 Peter 2:24. Jesus of Nazareth was crucified, but not for any sins of his own. He had nails driven through his hands and feet for my sins, for your sins. The Son of God himself bore our sins in his body nearly 2,000 years ago. Marvel at the fact, but do so much more than marvel. It is not simply a moment in history to be remembered and appreciated, like the storming of the beaches of Normandy on D-Day, which we remember is tomorrow, December 7th. Jesus wore a crown of thorns so that I might die to sin. Jesus was suspended between heaven and earth for 6 hours so that you and I might die to sin. When we, quote, die to, unquote, something we leave it behind. We separate ourselves from it. What shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who died to sin still live in it? Romans chapter 6, verses 1 through 2. Jesus the Christ died so that you might have that opportunity. He bowed his head and gave up his spirit so that we could live to righteousness. When we live to something, we orient everything else around it. We set it as our primary focus and goal. In the very last book of the Bible, the Apostle John was shown an incredible vision of heaven, which included a lamb standing as though it had been slain, Revelation 5:6. The slain lamb is Jesus. He allowed himself to be slain so that you and I may be healed. Let's remember that as we partake of the Lord's Supper. Let's pray. Father God, Lord, I thank you for the gift of your Son, for your love, that you loved us so much you were willing to send Jesus. And Jesus, thank you that you loved us so much that you were willing to take our sins and you were willing to die for us on Calvary, on a cruel cross. And as we partake of the emblems this morning, I just pray that we remember the great sacrifice that was given because of your love. Bless the bread that represents your body and the juice that represents Christ's blood. Ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So we continue worshiping. Let's all stand and be singing together, Living Hope.
The chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through shadows of my soul.
The work is finished, the end is written, Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my spoken. I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the
said, amen. You can be seated.
Good morning.
Morning.
Come on, turn. Before I start my meditation, though, I have a somewhat of a public service announcement. On the 21st of this month, I'm not sure if you're aware, the 21st of this month, if you go out right after sunset, right when the stars start coming out, you'll see in the southwest, so where the sun's setting, just to the left of that, you're going to see Jupiter and Saturn as close as they've been to each other in, I think, 800 years. So last time it happened was 1200 something. They call it the Christmas star, so I think it's kind of cool that it's happening right around Christmas Day. I don't know if it's what the wise men followed or not. I wasn't there. I tend to think that that was supernatural, but I think it's kind of cool. You can already see them. They're really close together now, but they're going to get closer, and we'll see if it turns into one star-looking thing. That's what I want, but we'll see. Anyway, on to my meditation. Have you ever heard a chickadee scratching its face? I did the other day. I was sitting in my tree stand with my son Ryan, and the only noise was the sound of the birds fluttering around the trees. And as I looked over at a tree about 10 yards away, there's a little chickadee sitting there, scratching his face, and I heard it. Now, we didn't get a shot at a deer that day, but Ryan had been able to get a doe a couple of days prior. And as I sat there listening to the birds and looking for the deer that I know were surely close by, I got to thinking about how God gave Adam dominion over the animals and all of creation from the very beginning. Genesis 1:26 tells us, "Then God said, let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals, and over all the creatures that move along the ground. And later in Genesis 9:3, God gave us the animals for food, saying, everything that lives and moves about will be food for you, just as I have given you the green plants, I now give you everything. As I sat there hoping that one of those deer that I know were surely close by would walk out, I thought about how blessed I am that I was able to be sitting there on my land in my tree stand with my son, waiting for the opportunity to provide for our families. The Bible tells us in James 1:17 that every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. And also in Jeremiah 17:7-8, blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, whose confidence is in him. They will be like a tree planted by the water that sends out its roots by the stream. It does not fear when heat comes, its leaves are always green, it has no worries in a year of drought, and never fails to bear fruit. I hope that you too have been able to take some time to consider the blessings that you have received from God. Just as sure as I am that there were deer close by, just waiting to walk out, and even though they didn't, I'm sure that God has blessed each of you. So as we consider our offerings this morning, remember Jesus' words to his disciples captured in Luke 6:38. Give and it will be given to you. A good measure pressed down, shaken together and running over will be poured into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. Let's pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you so much. We thank you for creation. We thank you for the animals. We thank you for the plants. Father, we thank you for all of the blessings that you've given us. Father, I just ask that you just be with us as we consider returning a portion of those gifts back to you for your kingdom. It's in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen.
Mom will have to remind me to show you the picture of the three deer that I saw that were waiting for their takeout order at Bob Evans. You know, that's how that goes. Well, when you look for them, you can't find them. And when you don't want them, they're everywhere. I know we want to continue to be praying for our family members and loved ones. I know Dick Ashbrook continues to battle. I just appreciate that you would keep Dick and Sandra and their family in your prayers as he's still on a ventilator, and it's been just a long time. So pray for them in their coming days. And also, I know Holly McLean is recovering now. Her positive test came back, I don't know how many days ago, but she's feeling a little bit better yesterday. But keep Holly in your prayers, as I know she's down and battling the virus. I know there are others. So is there anything else in the room that we could update and share? Eve? Okay.
They live in Bowling Green. They've got two teenage daughters, Jenna and Sydney. They're all sick. Jim and Cheryl have tested positive for COVID. And the girls have not, but the assumption is they've got it. So please pray for them.
Okay. Magnum, is that there?
Magrum.
Okay, remember their family, mom and dad, Jim and Cheryl, and two daughters, and the mom and dad do have it, and assumption is that the girls do as well. Keep them in your prayers. Is there anything else? How about we go ahead and just take a few moments to be praying personally, just pray silently, and then I'll close. Yet again, Father, we continue to just come before you, just thankful for the blessings and our awareness of those. We know that you are moving and able, and still there is so much that is weighing heavily upon us. Family members and loved ones and neighbors and friends who are sick and struggling, and folks who are trying to make ends meet, be it financially or emotionally. We know that there is so much that is a distraction and a discouragement. We just pray that you would continue to renew us with your strength. Just fill us each morning for the day ahead. We just pray that you will continue to speak to us through your word, through the reminders of the season. Thank you for all that we can celebrate. Thankful for that celebration that extends around the world. We just pray for our missionary families and couples and those who are serving and fighting many of these same battles all around the globe. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. And I didn't mention while we were praying that Sarah Travis's back surgery got delayed, so if anybody wonders on an update or something, she has to wait for that. So just keep that in prayer. That's to be determined on that. But as far as the message, the sermon now. We're going to start this. It's a month-long series looking at these people. We'll call them the cast of Christmas. And just the idea and the people and the faces and the graphics, and that's the one that I put together for us. And this is a common series theme. Other people have used it. Here's a picture of the graphic. Outreach Marketing made a series called the same thing, Cast of Christmas. And I folded some of their ideas into our material. And I appreciate those who submitted. I think I have three images. These are your submitted angels that I got earlier in the week. There's one that came in, and there's another one, and there's a third one. So, and I can only share those three. I appreciate the ones that were shared later in the week, but typically slides are created on Friday. So the stuff that's come in later than Friday, I haven't used. And you know, you can still submit shepherds for future. We're going to look at the prophets. We're going to consider ourselves as part of the cast. Our biblical account, the foundation, if you want to turn to Luke chapter 2. There are only two of the four Gospels that have the information on Jesus' birth early, Matthew and Luke. Matthew will be the account that tells you about his earthly father, Joseph, and the wise men. And then Luke will be the only one that's our only source for what we know of the events in Bethlehem and the night that he was born. Mark and John just pick up and they introduce later in Jesus' ministry. But this is Luke chapter 2, and I'm reading from verse 8. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests." And it's very easy for us to see the angels as the proclaimers or the messengers. That's what their name literally means, as messenger. And the easiest way I have to illustrate this is to point out the word that we translate as angel in Luke 2:9, the original word is angelos. You see it up there. But it's also translated as messenger in Mark 1:2. It's the same word. It's the same root. Angelos, angelon. And this is Mark 1:2 and following. It is written in Isaiah the prophet, "I will send my messenger, angelos, ahead of you who will prepare your way. A voice of one in the calling in the desert, prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him." And so John came. So you see, John the Baptist is the messenger that is referenced in Mark chapter 1, verse 2. So you could argue that John is technically an angel. Okay, he is a messenger. That'd be a little different look for the top of your tree. You could put a picture of John the Baptist up there and somebody'd say, "What's the caveman topper on you?" Hey, that's an angel. You know, he is a messenger. And just like John, these angels, these messengers, they have a proclamation, and they're not afraid to share it. They light up the night sky, and you've seen a lot of the graphics and the illustrations of the angels talking to the shepherds, and a lot of us follow their lead in the same way. You've seen the Christmas lights and stars and mangers and nativities. I love that. You know, it's just be a bold messenger. Just proclaim it night after night. You know, and the angel's message essentially has two parts. We'll spend most of our time on the second part, but you hear good news, great joy, all the people. And the first part of the message is a Savior has been born. And if you can accept the first part, then the second part is available to you. So that first part there, Savior and Lord. And Luke 2:11 is about as power-packed in 18 words as you'll ever have assembled. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. Savior, Christ, Lord. If you want to get to the true meaning of Christmas, that's right there in three words. Jesus was, is, always will be Savior, Christ, and Lord. It doesn't matter the season. It doesn't matter what the year has delivered. It doesn't matter what the media is saying. Savior, Christ, Lord. You know, we're going to go through the cast of Christmas series, and I'm going to change a little bit. I'm not taking just one message. I think I told you earlier we'd have one message about Jesus. Jesus is going to be in all the messages. We'll talk about the prophets, particularly next week, and then the shepherds on the 20th, and look at ourselves as messengers or angelon at the end of the month. But Jesus will figure in every message. He has to. Jesus factors in every sermon. He should factor in every day, right? Savior, Christ, Lord. Good news, great joy, all the people. I hope we don't get tired of sharing this. This is the message. Jesus came for you. I would say as you're coming from that sign, from the east, if you would, the sign out by the road. Jesus is the gift. You are the reason. I think I'll take a picture of that, like put a gift tag on the leg of a manger that says you. You are the reason. And the angels are practicing what they preach, because they just shouted out to these humble, lowly shepherds. And Jesus is not only the Savior for the rich and the famous. Jesus is not only the Savior for the happy and the healthy. Jesus didn't just come for people who have at least 100 followers and no problems in their past. For you, me, everybody. Daryl Bach wrote this. He said, those on whom God's favor rests, that includes people whose claim to fame can be nothing more than they get up each day and pursue a living in service to God. That can be me, that can be you. You know, good news, great joy, all the people. That's the first part of the proclamation. We'll keep revisiting that throughout the month. But the second aspect's a little bit more specific for today. This peace on earth idea, verse 13, 14. Suddenly a great company of a heavenly host appeared with the angel praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests. And on whom his favor rests part, that's crucial. Okay? If you accept him as Lord and Savior, then his peace can be available to you. If his favor isn't on you, yeah, it can be tough to have some peaceful days. Look at the world. You know, we always say that's what the world needs now, and then that makes my head think, what the world needs now is love. It needs love. It needs peace. It needs the Lord. Peace on earth. That's the constant greeting even still of the Jewish congregation. You know, when they meet and when they part, shalom. Peace. You might be familiar with churches that will say, peace be upon you. And I looked that up, and it's across the board. Christian tradition, Jewish tradition, even the Islamic or the Muslim worship. They're all looking for peace. You know, how many people? There's little evidence of it in the news, but that's what people are looking for. One of my favorite, it's a newer Christmas song to me, is Casting Crowns. I heard the bells on Christmas Day. It's new software. I tried to put in about a minute of it. It'll cut off. And you get so peaceful in the first part, and then you know the second verse is coming. I bow my head. There is no peace on earth. That's the reality. People want peace, and they live in this world. You know? And I was going to list headlines from the news, but it's just depressing, and you know it. You know, I mean, every day we look in there's not a lot of headlines about peace. If you and I are going to be the modern day angelos, the angels, the messengers, if I'm going to share peace on earth, then the first order of business is I have to possess it. I have to live in it myself. How peaceful are things in your little corner of the world right now? And that'll cut two ways. Sometimes we have with the pandemic and the restrictions, we actually have fewer obligations, so it's a little more peaceful. And then the same people will say, with all the restrictions and the problems, I'm more stressed, and it's less peaceful. You know, I like this quote from Outreach Sermon Series. No one expects you to be perfect. However, it's difficult to proclaim the message of God's peace when we're stressed out, overwhelmed, and exhausted. Our proclamation must first begin with us accepting and embracing the peace we have in God. That sounds pretty fundamental, doesn't it? Pretty basic, accept the peace. How many Christian people struggle with this? It says, despite all the talk of peace and grace in Christian circles, how few of us feel like we can just receive the peace of God without having to work for it or earn it or prove that I'm worthy of it? Check the angel's words. There's no effort from the people there. It's nothing that the shepherds did that went up. It's just, here's a gift. It is freely given. 2:11, a Savior has been born to you. We don't earn it. His favor rests on us because we accept him. We put our faith in Jesus and the cross. And you, there's a good example in Luke 7, the woman who it says she lived a sinful life. And in verse 37, she's washing Jesus' feet with her tears, you know, drying them with her hair. And then later in verse 48, Jesus says, your sins are forgiven. And then later in verse 50, Jesus concludes with saying, your faith has saved you. Go in peace. You know, because of forgiveness of sins, because I'm willing to accept Jesus, as I have peace. That's why the angels are saying, glory to God, Savior and Lord. And I know I've talked, there's a lot of people out there say, oh yeah, I'll take a Savior, but they have struggled with the Lord. I don't need a Lord. You know, there's all the conversation about who's in charge of who and who's doing what job. And Chris Collinsworth got in trouble the other day because he tried to compliment a couple ladies for their knowledge of football in Pittsburgh and created this whole brouhaha. So you don't think women? He's like, not what I said. You know, we get that here all the time. You know, oh, your church is terrible. You know, male dominated. Look, we're all servants of the same Lord. Okay, male, female, everybody needs to submit. This is not just Jesus being head of household. You know, Lord, I'm not interested in fighting over who's in charge of what. You know, Jesus is Lord of both of us. You know, in order to walk and remain in the peace Jesus brings, I need to be disciplined where I allow my mind to go and the things I think about. They said this is from Rick Warren. I never heard it before. Think about what you think about. Think about what you think about. In Scripture words it this way, 2 Corinthians 10:5. We take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. How well did I do that last week? Just check yourself. You know. When it comes to living in peace and proclaiming peace, it's possible to lose that battle in your mind before the interaction with someone else even starts. Have you ever had a fight or a disagreement with a relative or a friend and it took place completely in your brain? Yes, I've had those fights. You know, so sometimes you need to prepare your heart and mind for interactions that's going to be challenging, but rather than just preparing to defend myself or fight, can I think, maybe I want to approach this a little bit differently this time? And the verse that gives a backbone to that is Hosea 8:7. They sow the wind and reap the whirlwind. I'm not going to ask if you've ever done that, because I know you haven't, but you probably know somebody that has. You know, you just think it up in your brain, and it just becomes worse than the reality actually was. They whip up trouble and just keep spinning and gets worse. Peace possessors use wisdom and patience instead of jumping to conclusions or quickly misinterpreting other people's actions or intents. Peace possessors refuse to take offense when they feel slighted. They refuse to allow their own thoughts to turn to a careless or insensitive comment and turn it into a personal attack. Peace possessors won't give themselves over to a rumor or pick up an offense that's based on one side of the story or because somebody reinterpreted the story. Peace possessors always hope, always believe, always endure. What I possess, if I possess peace, then I can pass it on. I can proclaim it. I can share it with somebody else. And I thought that this was a bizarre story. You know, I'm going to share it with you. Did you know that ancient Egyptians used ostrich eggs as deodorant? Michael Debzik, Mental Floss, May 7th, 2019. 8 ways people made themselves smell good before deodorant. They mixed the eggs with nuts, tamarisk, and tortoise shell and rubbed it on themselves to cover body odor. So if you did not know this prior, you do now. What I possess, I have shared with you. Not a one of you are going, what am I going to do with that? What is the point of that? I possess it, sure. I don't want to pass it on. It's just my hope and prayer that that's not the only thing you remember from an entire month of Christmas sermons. What'd you learn at church? Oh, ancient Egyptians rubbed ostrich eggs on themselves. That's what my preacher preached. I want to possess. I want to proclaim the message that the angels had. They wake up the shepherds and probably all the sheep. Hey, you guys got to hear this. We don't care if it's the middle of the night. This is going to change your life. And God's calling us to be messengers. I thought, isn't there a group? And there is a group called We Are Messengers. You know, that's their job. And the evidence, we all know this, the evidence of God is all around us. I thought this was a great picture from science. We breathe in what the trees breathe out. And they breathe in what we breathe out. Just the design. It's all out there, but God still leaves it to us to tell people who he is, what he does, why he cares. Romans 10:14. You know, how can they hear without someone? We're all preachers, without someone preaching or teaching. You know? And Christmas can be a tough time. I know Christmas can be a tough time to just exude peace to everybody. The truth is, most families experience relational pressure and difficulties during this season. Nearly every family gathering has at least one relative who requires extra grace. And if you don't know who that relative is, it's probably you. It says, for how many families Christmas can bring more strife and conflict rather than less? For how many families Christmas is a reminder of the lack of peace? We don't have it in the family. Don't have it in the lives. We have conflict, many of us, with parents, children, brothers, sisters. We just want to survive the holiday. I don't want the same old fights and the same old antics and the same old issues. Many of us are struggling to keep it together. I just want to cling to whatever peace I can hold on to in my heart until it's all over. That might be where I am, but I want to stay there. I want to possess a peace that enables me to share the peace. I want to be a messenger. So I think I got 1, 2, 3 there at the bottom, these ways that I can proclaim or pass on or share peace. One of them, I can proclaim peace through my service. I can be a servant. Colossians 3:12 says this, therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. It is very difficult to argue kindness. People will argue your opinion. We know that. They will argue your politics, definitely, and probably your beliefs. But it's hard to argue serving. 1 Peter 4:10, each one should use whatever gift he has received to serve others, faithfully administering God's grace in its various forms. If you looked in the boxes that we had out in the foyer for Thanksgiving, it was a great illustration of the combination of different gifts. There were home-baked goods in there. There were drawings and paintings. There were cards and notes. You know, different people combining to serve. And we have on the table now, we have the start of the Christmas list for the families. There's a couple families out there. And if you see something that you want to purchase in that little box, I think it's technically a tally mark. You know, make a little 1, 2. I'm going to get one of those. And it'll be a combination of efforts serving. Post office is crazy right now. Okay? You probably should know that, but I'm just telling you. You know, it's worse crazy than normal. You know? And I don't know, maybe your work's the same way. I know there's some people working today. You know? And that's the setting when you're saying, how can I serve my coworkers? That proclaims peace. Proclaiming peace through righteousness, which is interpreted, be a good guy. I don't want to be somebody that contributes to the divide in the community because people have different understandings of who I am. You like that guy? Well, he's a jerk. Or my interaction with him is this. I want to be consistent. I don't want to be hard to be around. You know, and Jesus never said, he did not say, never remove the speck from your brother's eye. But he did say, start with your own plank. Can I be personally, consistently, truthful, patient, dependable, righteous. You know, that'll just proclaim peace. There's a Jesuit priest, Carl Rainer. The number one cause of atheism is Christians. Those who proclaim him with their mouths and deny him with their actions is what an unbelieving world finds unbelievable. And the last one is in our celebration. Can I proclaim peace? Even in the celebration, I don't know what your celebration plan normally is. I don't know if there's, you know, we all have traditions and now we're kind of like on the verge, can we keep doing it this year? But a preacher shared this story. It said it's a true story. They found it in the New York Times, and it was verified by Snopes. But it says it's a Christmas tradition. I don't know if you heard, these two guys are brother-in-laws, Larry Kunkel and Roy Coletti, Minnesota, 1964. And Larry's mom gives him a pair of moleskin pants, which in the Minnesota winter didn't work. Okay, it was just, you couldn't wear them. They froze up. So he regifted them to his brother-in-law, and Roy kept them for a year, and then he sent them back to Larry. Only he wrapped them up as tight as he could in a one-inch pipe just to make them harder to get open. And thus the tradition was born. These pants went back and forth for 25 years. Roy sent the pants to Larry in a 600-pound safe he had welded shut. The next year, Larry responded by sending the pants in a 3-foot cube of metal that had at one point, when it started, been a 1974 Gremlin with a note that said, "The pants are in the glove box." Roy sent the pants back with an 8-foot tire filled with 6,000 pounds of concrete with a note that said, "Had a good year." Says their tradition ended when Roy tried to have the pants encased in 10,000 pounds of jagged glass. He was just going to take this paint and shatter it on his yard. But the molten glass melted the pants to ashes. And thus the tradition has stopped, they think. You think about that, it's like, in what ways, and I love traditions, I'm not saying don't have traditions, but sometimes you stop and think, in what ways do our traditions celebrate or proclaim Jesus? And I sent a Flock Notes text out on Friday. If you don't get the text, I can send it to you later, but if you got it, and it's a long list, it's like celebrations that you can have, especially with your kids. There's a long list, and I don't even know if you scroll through, but clear at the bottom, it even broke down the opportunities by age. You know, if your kids are birth to 3, do this. If they're 4 to 7, do that, et cetera. You know, and there's always that conversation. Every year you have that conversation. How do we balance the whole gift giving and the cost? You know, personally, I love to give gifts. And let's be honest, I like to open presents. You know, but I like this perspective. If you decide that the only way Christmas can be a success is by getting everyone everything they want, even though you can't afford it, you are not proclaiming peace in your life or theirs. You are guaranteeing stress, guilt, and dissatisfaction in your heart. You're fostering entitlement in the lives of your loved ones. And that's a gift that just keeps on taking. Because the more entitled someone feels, the more they demand. And you will get to reap the payments and the interest on those gifts for months to come. You'll get to live in the stress of Christmas all year long from the choices you make right now. Like, yikes. You know? Then they came back. Counter that, contrast that with sitting down with your family and helping them understand what you really want Christmas to look like. What are our realistic expectations? And the author said, if your children or your family can only be happy if they get everything they want, maybe you're doing them a favor by disappointing them. Maybe you'll be proclaiming a peace in their hearts that will last for the rest of their lives, which is this: my life is not completely concerned with, consumed by, or centered on me. That's a tough attitude to realize, but it'll help you have real peace. And the sooner I can figure it out, the better. You know, who are you going to be around? Christmas season, who am I going to be around? How do I proclaim the peace of Jesus to them? Is it better to speak or I let it go? Somebody said, I've just learned that just because you're right doesn't mean you're being righteous. And sometimes you have to say it. Sometimes you have to say, this is a hard thing, you need to hear it. The loving thing is, I'm going to stand up for the truth. This is what you need to hear. And other times the righteous thing is, I don't have to be right. I'm not going to take the bait right there. I know you're just trolling for an argument for Christmas. So I'm not going to do it today. The message of peace that I want to proclaim is Jesus Christ, Savior, Lord. That's the message. Christmas and beyond. You know, if you can encourage people to accept Jesus, then they open themselves up to this peace. Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. Suddenly a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have shared the message with us. We can read it, we can hear it, we can talk about it, ask questions, understand, internalize, apply. There's so much that we can do, and we pray that you would give us the willingness, the courage, the conviction to proclaim your peace. We know what you provide and what you bring to our lives. We pray that we can live it in such a way that is attractive and that others will be enticed or encouraged to ask and seek. And Father, even for those that want to ignore us, we pray that we can have the confidence and the boldness to share your message. It is you being Savior and Lord which will provide the peace that endures. It's Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. And we always encourage you, we always invite challenge. If this is the day that you know you need to give your life to the Lord to be immersed into him, now we invite you to do that. Let's all stand together. We'll sing this morning for an invitation. Come just as you are. I alluded briefly in the sermon, there's a couple of lists now. We're still waiting on one family. One of the two lists that we have now, one family has two children, and the other, I think, has six or seven. But they're on a grid out there, and I'm thinking a little tally marking, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. If you say, I'm going to take this girl in size 10, purple, I'm going to get those shoes, put a little mark in that box. You know, somebody else says, I'm going to get her two pairs of pants. That's the best system I can think of. We left little scraps out there if you need to make yourself a list. Like we said, we'd get this, and this. And then next week and beyond, there'll be boxes in the foyer for first family, second family. And just if you can remember number one or number two down through the six kids because they don't have names on them. So hopefully that's clear. If it's not, you can ask me out there later. But if you want to help, I know some folks have given us cash already that we'll just use to supplement and fill in those gifts. So that's what I know for that event and meeting today for the youth. Eve?
I'm sorry, did you already say this? Do the gifts need to be wrapped?
No, I did not say that, thank you. They don't need to be wrapped. You can just bring them here, and that way the family can see them and know what they're going to be. You know, just bring the gift here. And if that's what you want to do, if you want to buy wrapping paper or something, that can be your contribution too. But yeah, just bring them here unwrapped, and we'll let them take care of that. Anything else? Would you pray for us?
Sure. Let's pray. Father God, again, we thank you for the opportunity to worship and the freedom that we have to do that. Father, I thank you for those men and women that protect those freedoms each and every day that serve in our military. Father, I just ask your protection upon them. Father, I pray that you help us to be messengers as we go out, whether it be to our neighbors, to our schools, to our people we work with. Father, help us to portray your love and share the good news of your son, Jesus. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Let's close this morning by singing Emmanuel.